I'm ZimZoe, and this video is for my Bath 2016 holiday, and it's going to be part one of the Lost Legends of the Stone Circle, which, if you don't know, it's this maze where you go around and you listen to legends or stories, and when you first go in, you get given a piece of paper for the Bard's Quest, and you've got to listen to these stories to answer all the questions, and if you get them all right, you get a medal. It's at the same place as King Arthur's Labyrinth, which is like this underground, well, labyrinth that's underneath a mountain, and you go in through it and you listen to all of the stories from King Arthur, and you go through like a waterfall and there's dragons, and it's really cool. But it's very dark and very cold, and you're not allowed to use flash photography. So I haven't filmed any of that, but I made sure to get the Bard's Quest. But the entire thing is about 45 minutes long, so I thought, that's not going up in one video. So it'll be in two, maybe three? I haven't quite sorted out the timings yet. So, multiple videos. And this one has got the first, I don't know whether you'd count it as three, as four stories. Well, it's got three stories and the intro, which is also like a bit like a story. But anyway, I hope you enjoy.
Who wakes me from my sleep? Who's there pulling me up through the slender veil that keeps our worlds apart? Oh, it's you. One moment. Sorry. I've been asleep a long time. Huh? Oh, yes. I know I have a face like a knot in an acorn tree. So what? A voice as old as a newborn rock, that's me. What do you seek? What do you want from me? Oh, so it's a story you need. Well, I've stories enough. I feed on telling them, but not as fatly as I used to, no. There's less of me than there once was, but every tale I tell to those who want to hear makes my figure full. And they're still here, oh yes, the tales, waiting in woods, under moss, under stone, lying in lakes and old white bones on mountain tops. True? Oh, most of them are true, and most are not. They be a summer crop, cut down by time, that lie now beneath the surface of half-forgotten rhyme. Who am I? Well, let's say I am your mother's niece, for it was there you first heard the magic words that maketh me once upon a rhyme. Awake now am I. Ready to begin. Welcome, welcome, come in. Into the maze of beginnings, middles, ends. A world of wizards, giants, fairies, which most folk now deny. Not you? Good, good. Then go and seek the tale. Search near and wide with ear and eye. Voices you will hear, visions you will find. North or west, the quest remains the same. Yes, my friends, to find your way home again. Good luck. Good luck. I am never far. Well then, here I am. And here you be and all, by the lake. Out of this one comes the loveliest tale of love and loss I ever told. Long ago, there lived a young man called Piwasson. How long? Well, his father was killed by the Normans, so they say. He lived in a village called Mudby, near a lovely lake named Llyn y Fan. Piwasson would watch over his sheep as they grazed the steep hills, and he would watch the surface of the lake for hours and hours.
Piwasson, what is it?
Something I saw. Something amazing.
Oh, sit down, sit down.
I was watching the surface of the lake when slowly out of the water came a herd of ghost-like oxen.
Why?
And they were driven by a swan.
Oh, why?
The swan turned into a beautiful woman.
Oh, why?
Will you stop saying that?
You've been eating them mushrooms again?
No, this was real. I ran toward her and held out my hands.
Oh, that's very forward of you.
I couldn't help it. She was so lovely, and I had this feeling.
Oh, aye, feelings now.
In my chest, she offered me bread and said,
take it and eat as a sign of our friendship, Piwasson.
Well, that's all very well, but tonight is New Year's Eve, North Callan. You have got friends coming over.
Oh, no, I can't.
Where are you going?
To the lake.
But it's night time and misty and the moon is full.
Piwasson returned to the lake and watched for many hours until he saw a piece of bread floating on the surface. He reached out and took it. And as he did so, the water rustled and out came the herd of oxen and behind them a small golden boat out of which stepped the Lady of the Lake.
Beautiful lady, I'm a shepherd, not used to saying what's in my heart. But I know that I love you truly.
Hush now, Luasa. Words are not needed. I feel the same. So well you have watched over us.
Then on my knees, I beg, come with me and be my wife.
As I love you, the answer is yes. But you are mortal, and I immortal. Therefore, there is a condition to our marriage.
I care not what it is. I will keep it forever.
This is the condition. If you should ever strike me 3 times, then I will return to the other world from which I came.
I accept. Why should I ever strike you, whom I love so well?
They were married and lived happily. And the oxen grazing on the hillside made them wealthy. But their greatest treasures were their sons and daughters. Many years passed. Then one day they were at a christening, and Piwasson was impatient to get back to the farm.
It's time to go.
Just a little longer. This moment should be treasured.
But the herd needs feeding. Come.
No, not yet.
Come, I urge you. Time is going on. What is it?
You tap me on the shoulder. Oh, Rwathon, remember the old words. Now you have struck me once.
Oh, my love, forgive me. I shall never strike you again. I promise it.
Time passed. Then they were at a wedding.
Why are you crying?
Because I, who am immortal, can see the troubles and sorrows that lie in wait for these young lovers who marry today.
Well, very well, but stop crying. It's a wedding, after all.
I can't.
You must. People are staring.
No.
My love?
Oh, Llewellyn. Oh, my dear husband, you have struck me twice. We have only one chance left. Promise you will never strike me again.
As I love you, I promise, I promise.
Time passed. Then they attended a funeral for an old friend of Piwasson.
Why are you laughing?
Because our friend is now in a state of happiness. all sorrows past.
Still, this is a funeral. Now cease your laughter.
I cannot.
Stop, I beg you. Oh, no. I didn't mean... Oh, no, please. Come back.
Farewell, my dear, dear husband. You have struck me a third and last time. Goodbye, my love.
Before his eyes, she was transformed. And for a moment, he saw her as she had been the very first time he had seen her. And then, she vanished. Every night, Rhiwallon came to the lake and grieved. But he never saw his love again. But one day, years later, his sons were at the lake when they heard a voice.
My sons! My sons!
They ran to her and knelt before her, and she blessed them with kisses.
Your work, my sons, is to become great healers. Have no fear. I will guide your footsteps and show you the healing herbs.
Then once more, she was gone. Sons became the physicians of Mudvai, famous for their many curious remedies.
Who's that weeping now? Oh, I. That's the Lord of Hlin. But why does he weep so? He has many servants, cattle, sheep. I'll tell you why. But be careful not to laugh, for laughter can be cruel. The fact is that Marc, the Lord of Hlin, has ears the size and shape of mules. And the only man who knows the size and shape of Marc's ears is his barber, Ivan. He alone knew his master's shame and all his fears.
I am not a vain man. I know. But if people were to see me, their king, with such long ears, they would laugh at me. And if they laughed, how could I rule? Where would be the law?
I got no idea, sir. Where would it be?
Now, you are a fool, Bivan. A fool who probably cannot keep a secret.
I will not tell a soul, sir. On my life, I promise.
On your life? Very well. Keep your promise, Barber, or you will cut hair no longer.
No, I cut it shorter, as a rule.
Oh, fool. If you tell anyone, I will cut off your head. With your own scissors.
On my life, I promise.
So Bivan the barber kept the secret close to his heart. But very soon it began to tear this simple man apart. He grew quite sick and called the...
Doctor! Doctor!
Shush now, Bivan. Stop wailing. There's nothing wrong with your body, so what plagues your mind?
It's a secret.
Well, what is this secret? You can trust me. I'm a doctor.
Yeah. I can't tell you, because it's a secret.
Don't waste my time, Bivan. I'm a busy man.
If I tell you, I will die.
If you don't tell someone this secret, you're going to die anyway. It has lodged inside you and gone poisonous.
Poisonous? No.
Can't you tell your wife?
She's a wise woman and does not believe in secrets. She hasn't kept one in all her life, not even in a jar.
Very well. This is your cure. Follow it or die.
I will. I promise on my life. Oh, I wish I could stop saying that.
Tell your secret to the earth.
The earth?
Aye. Go up high to some lonely spot upon the mountain and whisper your secret to the earth.
Well, lonely spot. Here I am, and this is my secret. Earth, listen. Even though I be a fool, my master, Marc, Lord of Fion, has ears the size and shape of mules.
In a moment, Bivan the barber felt better, and he danced down the mountain happy and carefree, now that he had shared his secret. But he did not see that at that very spot there grew straightway some lovely reeds. And a short time after that, a young musician came by and said,
"What lovely reeds! I shall cut one and make a new pipe. Oh, what tune it will play at the banquet of my lord, King Marc."
"Now, my people, I would like to hear some music. You, piper, where do you come from?"
"My lord, I come from Malgungwinedd. My name is Enoch."
"Never mind. Play the pipes well, and you'll be richly rewarded. Play, play."
So the piper put his pipes to his lips, and the pipe sang out clear as clear.
Bivan,
my lord,
you have told my secret, and you shall die, you and this piper.
"No, my lord, I told no one, except the earth."
"The earth?"
"My lord, be merciful. This pipe I made this morning, from a reed I cut upon the mountainside, it is bewitched. It will only play one tune."
"Well, give it to me. I will play the pipe."
And the king laughed and laughed at himself, so light of heart he was, now that the heavy burden of his secret was gone on horns and pipes. And he spared the lives of Bivan the barber and Enoch the piper, and his people rejoiced in his mercy. Blodeuwedd. She was lovely, lovely as laced meadow sweet and the flowers of the oak, and yet too cruel to live, it said, for she was not as other folk. This is her story.
Llew was a lord fair and young, but on his life lay a curse from a witch's tongue.
"Though you be young and bold and made so fair in life, never shall you wed upon this earth a human wife."
Gwydion, his uncle, had sorrow in his heart for young Lord Llew, and as he was true in kinship, so he planned with wisdom to make all things well again. He rode as fast as a good man may to Math the magician. Together, deep in thought and forest, they worked long and magic hours and contrived to conjure up a wife for him, and she was made of flowers. Lovely she was to hear and to behold. Blodeuwedd she was named, and of her beauty tales were told, but her deed brought a darker fame. Happy they were, these two, in love, Blodeuwedd and her prince, until the day Lord Gronwy on his horse rode by, hunting stag in the country wide. Lord Gronwy's eyes wandered from his natural prey and fell upon the lovely face magicians made, and from that day a passion burned inside them both that could only die in death. Their desire burnt through the pledges they had made to others, and now in secrecy they made another to kill Fair Heo, whose life lay between them and their pleasures. In the early hours of trust, when all men speak truly as they must, Heo told his love the secret of his enchanted life. No simple death would do for him, he told his loving wife. I cannot be slain on horse or foot, nor in a house or outside of it. How then may you be killed? Asks the innocent. And like all fools in love, he gave in to her pressing will. I can only be slain by a spear that takes a year to make, and only made on Sundays. You see how little I must fear. Blodeuwedd, hot with love, made Heo show how all this could be done. And when her thoughts were set and cold as stone, she sent Gronwy the deadly news how to make the spear, what wood to use, and having made it, without thought or fear, Gronwy, Lord of Penllyn, plunged it deep into the side of young Lord Heo. Heo screamed as the spear struck home, breaking off, leaving the head inside the wound, blood foaming at his mouth. Heo screamed, his skin to feathers turned, his mouth into a beak, his fingers into talons, and as an eagle then he flew, far from reach of further harm. For many months, Gwydion searched the mountains for him, and to lure the eagle to his side, he sang this song far and wide. Between two lakes an oak there grows, sheltered from the wind that blows. I think I do not tell a lie. My nephew Heo rests there on high. The eagle heard his friend and lord, and flew down freely to his feet. Then, so they might truly meet as men, he turned himself once more into the man he used to be. The sooner I can be revenged, the better pleased, said he. And forthwith, he returned the spearhead to the man who had made it. He plunged it straight into Lord Gronwy's heart, without regret or tears. Blodeuwedd, full of fear, fled into the hills with all her maidens dear. At last they came upon a lake, and having nowhere else to run, there drowned themselves all but one. Blodeuwedd, who stood alone to face the man who gave her life, so that she might be the wife of young Lord Heo. Gwydion in pale anger stood before the maiden he had loved of late and said, a beauty you may be, but cruel. So this shall be your fate. Swiftly you may fly from here in the shape of a bird. So great has been the hurt you caused my nephew Heo, that I forbid you to show your face in day. Between you and other birds, I lay a frost of enmity and dread. He touched the bitter maiden once, and with a cry of terror and a taste of blood, she turned into an owl that people to this day call Blodeuwedd, the flower face. Then with sad and silent looks, she softly flew away.
And that's where I'm going to end this part. But I still do have about 5 stories left, I think. So those are going to go up in the next part, or next 2 parts. But I hope you've enjoyed today's video, and have a nice day.